Hi, my name is Emil. I'm a founder and CEO at Tomorrow Bio. 2023 was the first year where we did real cryopreservations. In the years before, we've done a lot of training cases, and so we did in 2023 as well, but the first patients that are actually long-term stored in our storage facility in Switzerland were in 2023. Now in 2024, all the reports have already been published on our webpage. In this video, I will explain how those cases of last year went, how the details of every case turned out, and how we think about quality in general. But now let's get into cases. Last year, 2023, we did 4 cryopreservations. 3 of those 4s are fully completed. The reports have all the data. Now, after preservation, after the cryoprotection, we CT scan the brain of the patients that have been cryopreserved to see if the quality of the preservation was good. CT scans show if cryoprotective agent has reached a high enough concentration in the brain, in the tissue, to not let ice crystals form once you cool down. To quickly explain how to interpret these CT scans, what they basically show is density. CTs show density. That's why the skull is very, very white, meaning that shows high density. Then other areas of the brain are gray or different shades of gray. Now, in our case, we released these reports with pseudo color. So they're recolored to show in different shades of different colors. They show how high the percentage of cryoprotective agent is that has reached these parts of the brain. Red basically means low amounts of cryoprotective agent to none. Yellow means middle, but not good. And then green means this area of the brain has reached cryopreservation concentration or cryopreservation agent concentration that does not allow ice crystal formation if you cool it down fast enough. 3 cases, all of them were whole body cases. In one of the 3 cases, unfortunately, the patient had a big stroke before circulatory rest. So in the first case, you see basically different shades of yellow and then one clear area that is clearly, clearly red. That's the area which was affected prior to circulatory rest. And then due to effects to the rest of the brain, it's very difficult to impossible to completely perfuse the brain if there's any pre-mortem in fact. Now, in the other 2 cases, both of them went from a CT scan perspective very, very well. There was still a bit of delay after circulatory rest for logistical reasons, in both cases in the ballpark of 3 hours. Then you can see all the cooldown curves, you can see what has been done, what kind of medications were given, and so on and so on. All of that, of course, after the patient has been legally pronounced and handed over to us. And then in the end, you see 2 CT scans that by and large look relatively similar, where you see the whole brain in green, meaning the whole brain has gotten high enough concentrations of cryoprotective agents to avoid ice crystal formation after cooldown. There are some areas in the brain that are yellow, in the middle, for example, and in one of those 2 cases also on the top. These 2 areas are the so-called ventricles and dural sinus. In both cases, in those areas, there is no brain tissue. So neither gray nor white matter exists in those areas, basically a fluid-filled area that everybody has in the brain. So these areas don't need to be green because there is no brain tissue. So this is totally fine that they're yellow. All in all, these 2 cases have received really high in preservation quality based on CT scans. In fact, you see a quantification of that in the reports as well. The first report, you see what's the average concentration throughout the whole brain of this cryoprotective agent. And also in case 3 and 4, you see in those 2 cases, practically speaking, the whole brain has reached high enough concentration. In fact, in those cases, it's somewhere between 95 and 99%. So even though 95 to 99% sounds like a big difference, pretty much this is the same, meaning just the brain is well preserved. Doesn't have some small areas where there might be a vessel, where there might be an empty space and so on, that puts off these numbers a bit. By and large, the quality data just shows this is well preserved. One of those cases is a so-called immersion vitrofixation case. In this case, you do a chemical fixation first and then do cryoprotection after. And once cryoprotection is done, you cool down to cryogenic temperatures for the cryopreservation. The immersion vitrofixation is still ongoing here, so there's no final CT scan that will be added once the procedure is fully done. And in this case, the brain has been stored in cryogenic long-term storage. Here you see just a graph that shows the increase in concentration of cryoprotective agent that we see in a CT scan. Since we do this immersion vitrofixation procedure, the concentration of the cryoprotective agent is slowly increased over many, many months. While we continuously and regularly do CT scans, to check how high the diffusion, how much of the cryoprotective agent has already diffused into the tissue. And only once we do not see any increases anymore and have reached the terminal concentration that you need to reach to not have ice crystals form during cooldown, then we start with cooldown. Since you've done the chemical fixation first, it's not much of a problem that this goes very, very slow. But if these cases happen, you know, somewhere in the second half of the year, then and even in some cases, even if it happens in the first half of the prior year, then this immersion, this diffusion procedure takes somewhere between 9 and 12 months, meaning if the reports of the prior year will be published in the early parts of the next year, then the reports might not be fully done yet. And this is the case here in one of those. Now, it's very important to state that CT scans are a required step to show good preservation quality, but it's not telling you the full story. You wouldn't always need to look at CT scans, meaning we can avoid ice crystal formation, and at the same time, which we will add now, which is not being done in a standard case, you would need to look at the ultrastructure of the preservation, showing that on a cellular level, the connections are still there, you know, the synapses are clearly shown, the cell bodies, the neurons are still visible. Because technically, these two are not, they're not independent. These two values, like ultrastructure preservation and quality in CT scan, they're correlated, but in certain cases, you can achieve one that is very good and the other is very bad, or the other way around. So from now on, since we see that the CT scans in our last two cases look very good, we will add new quality metrics that will be added on, you know, in the next, you know, month and years to make sure that we can see a full picture of preservation quality. Now, when we think about cryopreservation quality, we never want to feel like, okay, now we're good enough. The goal of cryopreservation quality should always be to continuously improve. And when we think about quality, we think about responsibility. In cryopreservation cases, there are certain topics where it's directly our responsibility if something goes wrong, if we don't take the right equipment, if we don't do the right procedures. And then there are other topics where we still consider it our responsibility, but where the responsibility is a bit more indirect. For example, if we cannot get access to a hospital in the middle of the night, let's say someone dies in a hospital, we arrive, let's say in the evening, but then the hospital tells us that, well, you know, in our case, the pathology department hands out patients that have died, and the pathology department will only come back at like 6 a.m. next morning. In this case, of course, it's not directly in our responsibility, but we still consider it our responsibility because we could have told the patient to go to another hospital. Maybe in down the line, there will be hospitals where we know that there's some kind of 24/7 access. Whatever goes wrong in a cryopreservation case, we always think, what can we do better next time? And in fact, the last part of all the reports of a cryopreservation case that we publish will be, what went wrong in this case? How severe was this problem? And what have we or will we do to mitigate that problem next time? In fact, if nothing goes wrong, then I think we're not challenging ourselves enough, meaning we don't have high enough internal quality metrics, what we want to have, you know, optimized till, you know, you cannot optimize it anymore. But we should never feel comfortable by saying, you know, we have reached something. We should then think always about what can we do next. The important part is that all of the things that went wrong, and most of the things are just small optimization things. It's not really something that went wrong. It's just more so that you can do better here. All of these things have already been mitigated, meaning we found a solution that has been tested and now will be the standard procedure and the standard protocol going forward. A couple of things are still in progress, meaning we're still working on them. And then once they're done, we update the reports to show that now this has been completed as well. In cryopreservation cases, you can't expect everything to go right. But what you should definitely expect, and where you should call us out, if you see a similar or the same problem come up multiple times, then you should definitely call us out. So expect these reports every year. We're not only doing like these static videos on YouTube, but we also do live Q&A webinars for these videos. So check that video out and hopefully join us next year once we do the case reports for 2024. Should you have any questions about the procedures or quality or general cryopreservation or want to sign up, feel free to always reach out. We're more than happy to talk to you.